We are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 8. On Friday, June 30th, 2023, Ianthe Brathwaite, affectionately called Nets or Netta, of Topaz Avenue, Ealing Park South Christ Church, and formerly of Pounders, Crane, St. Philip, entered into rest at the age of 88. Predeceased by parents Clement Barrow and Miriam Louise Fort Garner, beloved mother of Cheryl Ford Sill, Lena B. Brathwaite Bell Anthony, Lloyd Brathwaite Jr., Lorna Wilson John, and Laurel Brathwaite Smith Anthony, adoptive mother of Malcolm Thomas, adored grandmother of Duane, Naka, Dominique, Brian, Neil, Danielle, Joshua, Omar, Amber, DeShannon, Amor, Elise, Lori, Luke, and Adam. Loving great-grandmother of Anya, Levi, Trey, Amari, Soleil Grace. Funeral leaves Clyde B. Jones Funeral Home on Tuesday, July 25th. For the Chapel of Coral Ridge Memorial Gardens, where relatives and friends are asked to meet for a Thanksgiving service to celebrate her life at 10 a.m. The cortege will then proceed to the Frangipani Lawns for the interment. You may also join the family via live stream at www.clydebjonesfuneralhome.com.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire, and in darkest night you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. Hey! 'Cause all my life you have been faithful.
Oh, yes, you have.
And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything, oh Lord. Your goodness is running after, it's running.
We thank thee each morning for a newborn day, where we may work the fields of new-mown hay. We thank thee for the sunshine and the air that we breathe, O Lord. We thank thee. Thank thee for the rivers that run all day. Thank thee for the little birds that sing along the way. Thank thee for the trees and the deep blue sea, O Lord. We thank thee. Oh yes, we thank thee, Lord, for every flower that blooms, birds that sing, fish that swim, and the light of the moon. We thank thee every day as we kneel and pray, that we were born with eyes to see these things. Thank thee for the fields where the clover is grown. Thank thee for the pastures where cattle may roam. Thank thee for thy love so pure and free, O Lord. We thank thee. Every flower that blooms, birds that sing, fish that swim, and the light of the moon. We thank thee every day as we kneel and pray, that we were born with eyes to see these things. Yes, we thank thee for the fields where they're clothed. Thank thee for the pastures where cattle may roam. Thank thee for thy love so pure and so free, O Lord. We thank thee. Just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. I have a loving mother just over in glory land, and I don't expect to stop until I shake her hand. She's waiting now for me in heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Just over in glory land we'll live eternally. The saints on every hand are shouting victory. Their songs of sweetest praise drip back from heaven's shore, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful. of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire, and in darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. Hey! 'Cause all my life you have been faithful.
Oh yes you have.
And all my life you have been so, so good. Every breath that I am able, oh I will sing of the goodness of God. Your
Brothers and sisters, please stand as we receive the body. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die. The hour is coming, and now is when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. We brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we shall carry nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. If we live, we live unto the Lord. And if we die, we die unto the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. Our Savior, Christ Jesus, abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. I am the first and the last. I am he who lives and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. And I have the keys of death and of hell. Because I live, you will live also. And death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain. For the first things are passed away. Brothers, sisters, friends, I greet you in the name of Jesus Christ, head of the church and savior of the world. And I welcome you to the service of thanksgiving as we celebrate the life of one whom we knew and loved. We sing to the glory of God the hymn, How Great Thou Art, O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the world thy hand has made. Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the world thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I looked down from
from lofty mountains grander and hid a brook and feel the gentle breeze. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. That God his Son, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then shall I bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art.
Please be seated. Let us go to God in prayer. Let us pray. Most gracious God, we turn to you in the sorrow and grief of our bereavement, praying that we may find the strength we need in your sustaining grace, so that even as we mourn the death of one whom we knew and loved, we may not be overcome by this trial, but we may hold fast, trusting in your goodness and mercy. Assure us, O Lord, our God, that death is not the end of those who trust in you. And may our hearts be so composed in the Holy Spirit that all fear and bitterness may be swallowed up in the light and peace you give to your troubled children. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty and eternal God, who by the Holy Spirit ministered to us in our weakness, and by the victory of your Son, Jesus Christ, have given us the pledge of eternal life, lift us, we pray, above our present distress and sorrow, and shed the light of your grace and glory upon us. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. My brothers and sisters, we are met in this solemn moment to commend our sister Ianthe Brathwaite into the hands of the Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who have sent his Son Jesus Christ to be our Redeemer, by whose stripes we are healed, and in whose name alone we have salvation. Let us then recall to mind the life of our beloved sister, and then in humble trust, hear the words of Holy Scripture. As our worship continues, the eulogy will be read by Mr. Dwayne Barker.
Good morning. My name is Dwayne Baker. I am the first grandchild of Ianthe Brathwaite. I am delivering this eulogy on behalf of our family. In the presence of our family and dear friends, we gather today to honor the extraordinary life of Ianthe Brathwaite, Mummy, Aunt Nita, Mrs. Brathwaite, Neats, Granny, or most fitting to us, the Queen. A woman whose strength, esteem, dignity, humor, and wise counsel touched the hearts of all who knew her. Mummy's journey began on this beautiful island, Barbados, on the 17th of February, 1935. Her parents were Clement Barrow and Louise Fort Garner. She was raised in the Crane, St. Philip. She embraced life with a spirit of joy and resilience, leaving an indelible mark on all those who had the privilege of knowing her. Mummy was not only insightful in the lives of her children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren, but also to countless others. Her devotion to her family and unwavering faith in God stood out among her many remarkable qualities. The book of Proverbs, chapter 31, describes a woman of her caliber as virtuous, one who led her home with integrity, cared for her children, and loved her God. Mummy embodied grace and class, rising above humble beginnings to achieve great and extraordinary things. She delighted in sharing tales of her youth and stories of her swimming at Crane Beach. Yet she objected strongly about her children and grandchildren going into the sea. She would always say, "The sea had a front door, but no back door." She also told of how she would powder her face and dress up to go to town to do her shopping. Mummy embarked on adventures around the world with her late husband, L.B. Brathwaite. She often recalls stories of meeting presidents and prime ministers from many African and European countries. Among the more memorable experiences she held dear was meeting Pope John Paul II at the Vatican. Another one of her unforgettable encounters was dining with the late Queen Elizabeth II on board the royal yacht Britannia during one of the monarch's visits to Barbados. Her entrepreneurial spirit shone bright as she owned and successfully managed two mini marts in Bridgetown. Her compassion knew no bounds, as evidenced by the many less fortunate individuals who left her mini marts with bags of groceries they didn't have to pay for, a testament to her kindness and compassion. Mummy became a mother figure to many, extending her love and care beyond her own biological children. As we reminisce about her and all she was, we cannot overlook Mummy's prowess in the kitchen, where her cooking and baking skills would tantalize your taste buds, leaving you yearning for more. If you had the opportunity to taste her secret recipe black cake, fish cakes, conkeys, and macaroni pie, then you know they were simply unparalleled and would knock your socks off. Mummy was a fashionista. known for her extensive collection of scarves and hats. She often reminded us, people out there don't have to know what is going on with you on the inside. So it's important to always look your best. She lived by that until her last days. In the past year, there was a moment when she was unconscious, and once she regained consciousness and was aware of her surroundings and need for hospitalization, she asked to be cleaned and insisted on wearing her scarf and earrings. It wasn't because our dapper queen was vain, but because she hailed from a generation of women who believed in always looking their best, even during their worst. Mummy never allowed her circumstances to define her life. One of her favorite quotes, "With Christ in the vessel, you can smile at the storm," echoed her joy de vivre, zest for life, and abiding faith in God. It kept her going even when her body became frail and was giving up. She never complained, but would always ask God for strength to help her endure. Mummy resisted owning a smartphone until her final year, when her mobility became restricted. This opened up a whole new world for her, allowing her to connect with her grandchildren scattered across the globe, as well as great-grandchildren, family, and friends. It never ceased to be a surprise to us when we received calls from her via WhatsApp, or when she told us that she watched some video or read some story via a link that was sent to her. Her mind was always sharp, right through to her passing. She embraced this newfound technology like a kid in a candy store, calling and encouraging everyone, looking beyond her own declining health. She possessed immeasurable strength and resilience, which persisted until her final moments. Her determination was truly remarkable. When it came to giving, Mummy lived by Matthew chapter 25, verse 40. The king will reply, "Truly I tell you, whatever you did for me, for the one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me." For many years, Mummy volunteered with the Red Cross to deliver meals to persons in need through their Meals on Wheels program, something that clearly stuck with some of her offspring, who in turn went on to volunteer in various pursuits. Mummy was a philanthropist. She would assist in preparing food hampers for the poor and indigent at Christmas. During the COVID-19 pandemic, Mummy would prepare care packages for persons who were less fortunate. She especially helped those families that had many children and mouths to feed. Mummy was a very loving and caring person and would always seek out those who were on the fringes of society. Indeed, Mummy was a theo-philanthropist. Her face would light up with joy whenever she had the privilege to help someone in need. She consistently reminded us of Jesus' call to assist people in need. During her time in the hospital last year, Mummy expressed a deep gratitude for being surrounded by children and grandchildren who loved and cared for her. She acknowledged that not everyone had the same support system. It was then that she reminded us, as she had done countless times before, of the importance of helping others whenever we could. She shared the story of an encounter she had with someone facing financial hardship, and she suggested that each of her children give $25 to help that person, and she would also contribute. It wasn't that she couldn't give the money herself. She wanted us to give not only as individuals, but as a united family. The lessons she imparted to us were invaluable. There, when she was ailing, still considering the needs of others, Mummy left a legacy that should be emulated by all. Mummy, Ianthe Brathwaite, was a compassionate and loving soul. She was a family-oriented mom. To the world, she was one person, but to us, she was the world. She made sure her children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren knew that she loved them. She didn't leave us millions, but a legacy worth much more. She taught us how to be thrifty, to be independent, and how to love the Lord. Mummy experienced many challenges throughout her life. However, these challenges developed characteristics that we hope are inculcated as part of our own lives. She was honest to a fault, loving, creative, disciplined, courageous, kind, and possessed an inner strength which was enviable. These she attributed to having a personal relationship with God. She relied on the power of prayer before she made decisions to do anything. Mummy reminded us of Philippians chapter 4, verse 13, which states that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That was her guide and mantra. She always encouraged us to strive for excellence in whatever we set out to do and to always rely on the goodness of God and to give thanks daily for his faithfulness. Her beauty and grace brings to mind Psalm 139, 14. You were fearfully and wonderfully made, and we know that marvelous are his works. Our stylish matriarch has left a void in our family. Her wise counsel will surely be missed. Her delight when she was told of the funny antics of her grandchildren and great-grandchildren, her daily check-ins to find out how we are and how our day was at work. We will always remember our Queen's unwavering support for family and friends. We will forever hold dear the precious memories we shared, her smile, her laugh, her love. Mummy, we thank God for choosing you to be our mother and grandmother. Although you are no longer physically here with us, you will always be cherished in our hearts. We know that you are safe in the arms of your beloved Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Until we meet again in the sweet by and by, rest in peace, dear Granny, dear Mother.
We continue with the tribute in song by Sister Paula Hines.
Good morning. Please accept my sincere condolences at the passing of your relative, and I pray God's peace, his strength, and his continued grace to all of you. God bless you. It's just queuing up, sir.
I dreamed of a city called Glory. It was so bright and so fair. And as I entered the gates of that city, the angels, they all met me there. They carried me from mansion to mansion. I said, I want. one who truly died for me. I bow on my knees and cry, holy. I cry, holy. Thou art holy.
Thank you so much, Sister Paula Hines, for that wonderful rendition, and thanks to Brother Mr. Dwayne Baker for the eulogy, reminding us of the life of our dear sister. My brothers and sisters, I greet you in the wonderful name of our risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Please forgive me for being so late. I have to blame it on old age and the stresses of life. They're catching up on me. I was just telling my superintendent minister that never in my life have I been late for a funeral. It goes against the grain, so I'm very sorry, and I hope you accept my apology. Sister Ianthe Brathwaite is with her Lord and Savior. She was an angel on earth, I've been told, one who was a real philanthropist. She gave to her family and friends, I'm sure, as you have heard. And of course,
She was very helpful in the society. She did not only raise her own biological children, but she certainly helped the children who were less fortunate in our island. She gave of her all. We can only say that she was a woman of grace, a Christian woman who loved God and lived her Christianity. And she worshiped at Hawthorne, where she enjoyed the fellowship. She gave her life to God. She was a servant leader. She loved the Lord and read the word daily. Therefore, she was able to stoically bear the illness with spiritual fortitude, which came upon her in her latter years. I'm sure that she is resting comfortably in the arms of her Savior. She served Christ and she served her fellow men. And it is evidenced by the number of persons here this morning. We can see the love that you had for this beautiful Christian lady. On behalf of my superintendent minister, who will bring the message a little later, and on behalf of all the officers and members of the Hawthorne Methodist Church and the Methodist Church family in general, and on my own behalf, I want to extend our deepest sympathies to her daughters, Cheryl Ford, Lena Brathwaite Bell, Lorna Wilson, Laurel Brathwaite Smith, and her sons, Lloyd Brathwaite Jr. and Malcolm Thomas, all her many grand and great-grandchildren, her nieces and nephews, her many friends. Our deepest heartfelt sympathies as you mourn the passing of your loved one. May God comfort you in this, your time of great sorrow. Please remember that God loves you all and God will always be there for you. So as you mourn, he will certainly be there holding your hand and giving you the comfort that is needed at this time. We give God thanks and praise for the life, the work, and ministry of our dear sister. And now we're going to continue as we turn to the ministry of the word, and we're going to stand and sing Psalm 23.
My shepherd, I will not want. He makes me down to lie in pastures green. He leadeth me the quiet waters by. My soul he doth restore.
You may be seated. We have the first scripture reading by Mrs. Amber Wilson.
The reading is taken from 1 Thessalonians 4:13 to 18. But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, so that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have died. For this we declare to you, by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will by no means precede those who have died. For the Lord himself, with a cry of command, with the archangel's call, and with the sound of God's trumpet, will descend from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up in the clouds together with them to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. This is the word of the Lord.
We shall stand as able for the reading of the gospel, and we will be led by Miss Anya Atwell.
The gospel reading is taken from John chapter 14, verses 1 to 6 and verse 27. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not let them be afraid. This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise be to Christ, our Lord. Thanks to both of you. Now we're going to sing the hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness, O God, my Father. And after the singing of the hymn, our superintendent minister is going to bring the message.
Faithfulness, Lord, unto me. faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have need in thy hand has provided.
Great is thy faithfulness,
Lord, unto me. And a peace that endureth, thine own their presence to share and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed thy hand has provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Amen. Please be seated. St. John chapter 14 and verse 1. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Let us pray. God, oh God, we give you thanks for your word. We thank you that your word does not return unto you void. We thank you for what your word will accomplish in this act of worship and particularly in our lives. So speak now, oh God, as only you alone can. Let the words of my mouth and the reflections of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, oh God, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. Jesus declares, do not let your hearts be troubled. When we are confronted with the reality of death, there are quite a number of ways in which humanity has come to regard death. Some people refer to death as being expired. Some refer to death as being done, the end of life. There's still some others who see it as a transition from one type of life to another in reincarnation. The Christian faith emphasizes three ways of considering the reality of death. First of all, the Christian faith, and we have seen this in the writings of Paul and Jesus' own expressions, that death is referred to as going away. There are other places where death is referred to as entering into your rest. And yet there is a third of falling asleep. And I like those three expressions: going away, falling asleep, or entering into your rest. Because these three ways of considering death tells us that the notion of being dead and done is not a Christian understanding of the reality of death. It tells us that death is not a state of being, but an event. And so Christians who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ are not dead. Rather, they have died. And so today we gather in this place, not to say farewell to someone who is dead, but rather someone who died, who has died. And there is a difference. Because to suggest that we are burying a dead person is to suggest that that is her state of being now and forever. But to suggest that we are burying someone who has died is to suggest that she has passed through the waters of death. That she has experienced the event of death, but is not dead. But according to the word of God, those who die in the Lord shall continue to live with the Lord Jesus Christ. And so in the passage that is before us from John chapter 14, as a matter of fact, if you go back to chapter 13, Jesus is talking to his disciples about his own death, his own hour of death. And Jesus is saying to them that when he goes to Jerusalem, that some things are going to happen there that are going to deeply disturb them. Things like he's going to be arrested, he's going to be condemned, he's going to be crucified, and he's going to die. And of course, the disciples were deeply broken by this news. Because the disciples had not considered that their Lord and Savior would have departed from them in this way so quickly. And so they were deeply, deeply broken. And Jesus, recognizing how broken they were, begins now to speak in chapter 14 words of consolation and hope and promise to them. And so Jesus says to them, "Do not let your hearts be troubled." Just as we are gathered here today, and no doubt your hearts are broken because a loved one has passed through death. Something has changed in a moment that someone you loved and touched and were able to interact with on such a personal basis is no longer physically present with you. And that brings brokenness of heart and spirit and can even cause our perspective on life to be skewed. But thank God for the word of Jesus to his disciples, which continue to minister to us today. Jesus says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled." And I want to reflect on what I want to call the four P's of a broken heart. The four promises that Jesus offered to his disciples and also offers to us who are gathered here. First of all, Jesus tells us to believe in a person. The first P is to believe in a person. Whenever a child is afraid in the dark at night, that child is usually comforted by the presence of a parent or the parents. The child will cling to mom or dad and begin to feel calm and reassured. In that hour of brokenness, in that hour of fear, in that hour of distress, Jesus said to his disciples that you can believe in a person who will be there for you, a person who can offer comfort and strength in your time of distress and trouble. Jesus says to them, "Believe in God, believe also in me." In other words, know that I am with you through this whole experience. Because the truth is that when we go through the valley of the shadow of death, when we experience troubled hearts, brokenness of spirit, it can often feel as though the whole world has abandoned us. Even though we may be surrounded by many persons who speak very beautiful words and persons who truly care, in that moment, in that dark moment, we can feel completely abandoned and alone.
And it is in that moment when we feel completely abandoned, completely alone, that Jesus reminds us that we can believe in one who is with us always. Hear what he says to his disciples. He says, I will never leave you, nor forsake you. I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. And so there are some persons who, when they think of the presence of God, they think of this distant presence, that God is distant, and there is this song that says, from a distance, God is watching us. May I submit to you that that is a lie from the pit of hell, because God is not a distant God. The Word of God tells us that he is a very present help in times of trouble. So the God who in Jesus says, believe in God, believe also in me, is not a God who's far away, distant, and a God who says to us, come up here and meet me. No, he is the God who comes down, and the God who meets us at our points of need, the God who meets us in our grief, the God who meets us in our brokenness, the God who meets us where life is troubling, the God who meets us when it feels as though we cannot carry on, the God who meets us when the rubber hits the road, the God who meets us when we come to the end of the road and there seems to be nowhere to go. He is a God who lifts us up and assures us that we are not alone, but we are in the hand of a mighty God who is more than able to take care of us. That's the God that our sister knew. That's the God that our sister served. And that's the God who helped her through her dark days. That's the God who helped her when life became overwhelming. That's the God that she experienced in her hour of illness. That's the God she clinged to and continued to profess faith, because she heard Jesus say, believe in God, believe also in me. The same word that Jesus assures us of today, that in your hour of grief, not just in this time of death, but as we go through various experiences that cause us to be broken, wounded, worried, afraid, Jesus comes alongside us, says, I've got you. I've got your back. And he takes us by the hand and he leads us through life. Sometimes it's troubling, but he takes us through nonetheless. Secondly, Jesus tells us that we can believe in a place. The second P is the P of place. First, he assured them, believe in God, believe also in me. Secondly, he says to them, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. Jesus was assuring the disciples that even as he goes through the waters of death, that this road was not leading to a bottomless pit, that this road was not leading to nowhere, but this road was leading to a place where the Father lives, a place that he has gone on to prepare for all those who will follow him in the future, a place that he has gone to prepare for those who will remain faithful in every season of their lives, a place that he has gone to prepare for those who believe that he alone is Lord and Savior of our lives. He has showed them that death doesn't lead nowhere, but it leads somewhere. So he says, I'm going away to a place that I will prepare for you. I want to submit to you today that as we say farewell to our beloved sister, mother, grandmother, friend,
that her destination is not the burial ground. It's not the cemetery. It's not the hole that has been prepared to receive her human remains. I want to submit to you that that is not her destination. I want to tell you today that that is where her human remains will lie. But her destination is at a place where Jesus has gone to prepare for her. And the Bible calls that place heaven. The Bible calls that place around the throne of God. In Revelation chapter 7, the writer John sees in his vision a large multitude around the throne of God, and he was asked, "Son of man, who are these people and where have they come from?" John says, "Lord, I don't know, but you know." The angel of the Lord said to him, "These are they who have come through the great ordeal, who have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb, and now they're around the throne of God, praising God night and day." The word of God tells him that in this place there is no more night, that in this place there is no more sickness, in this place there is no more pain, in this place there is no more death, but the Lord himself is on the throne. He is in the center, the midst of them, and they are all right. And so as we celebrate our sister's life today, I want to say to you that her destination is in heaven. And I hear the angel of the Lord echoing around the throne. She has arrived safely. She has arrived around the throne of God. And so we say glory, hallelujah to God. Another saint has entered in. My brothers and sisters, some people will say to me, "Rev, in this modern day, you're talking about something that we can't prove empirically, something that we can't find, something that is scientifically incompatible with what you are saying in this day and age." But I will say that I've learned to believe the report of the Lord, and his report is true. What he says is true. We have just sung, "Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All that I need, thy hand has provided. And I have no reason to doubt the tender mercies of God or the truth of the word of God, because everything that God's word has proclaimed has come to pass. And therefore, I believe that Jesus is right when he says, I've gone to prepare a place." And I believe that our sister has entered in, not because of her works, but because she gave her life fully to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, and he honors his word. And therefore I say to us that we must recognize that as we journey through this life, that one day this life will come to an end, and how we have lived with this life and for whom we have lived this life will matter in the end. We will either be united, reunited with those who have gone ahead of us who have served the Lord, or we will hear him say, "Depart from me, I never knew you." The third P, Jesus says, "Believe in my promise." To help us stay strong as we go through trouble, Jesus tells us to trust him as we go through these problems and to keep our hearts focused on where we are going, the Father's home. Number three, Jesus says, tells us to believe in a promise. Jesus says, "When everything is ready, I will come and get you, so that where I am, there you may be also." My brothers and sisters, we can trust the promises of Jesus. That every promise that Jesus makes will come to pass in this life and in the life to come. And that is why the Apostle Paul declared in Romans chapter 8, he says, "I am persuaded
I am persuaded that neither life nor death, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other being can separate me from the love of God, which is in Jesus Christ our Lord. Why? Because the Apostle Paul is saying, I believe in the promises of God. His promises are true. His promises shall come to pass. Even that which humanly is impossible, I'm going to believe the report of the Lord, because his promises are good for all times. And so Jesus says, I am going away, but I promise you that I will come again. And I will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And so again, I submit to us that there is more to life than this. There's far more to life that can ever be contained in this mortal body. And one day we will shed this mortal body so that we can experience the fullness of life that God in Jesus Christ intends for us. Let me say finally, Jesus tells us that we can believe in a plan. In a plan to get through the troubles of this life and of this world. Jesus tells us to believe in a person, to believe in a place, to believe in a promise, and finally says to believe in a plan. What is that plan? Thomas says, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How do we know the way? Jesus says to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. The plan is through Jesus, Jesus alone. Again, there are some who would say to me, Rev, there are many paths to the same place. They say, yes, I believe in your heaven. I believe in your paradise. But don't tell me that Jesus is the only way to that place. There has to be other ways. There has to be other paths. And again, Jesus echoes. He says, I am the only way. I am the truth. I am the life. Jesus declares that there is no other way. We can't get there simply by living a good life. We can't get there simply by living according to our rules. We can't live there simply by being good to people. Because there are some very good people who will end up separated from God. The only way is to make Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior. And that is why God sent his only Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. Jesus offered himself as a ransom so that human beings who are separated from God can be reconciled with God. It is the only way. The Bible tells us that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus the Christ. So there is only one plan. We either take it or refuse it. That one plan is to get there through Jesus. Our sister understood that. And in spite of all that she would have done, all that she would have achieved, she made Jesus the number one priority. And because she made Jesus her number one priority, she could not neglect the ways of the Lord. So all that she did came out of her faith. She was compelled by the Spirit, constrained by the Lord to do all that she did because she made Jesus her first love. It was not the other way around. It was not doing all of these things to appease Jesus, but because she had Jesus, the outworking of her faith was expressed in all that she did. My brothers and sisters, I want to challenge you today. Even as I challenge myself, because some of us would say, yes, I have made Jesus my own. But then we need now to allow Jesus to work himself out in our lives. For too many people, their Christianity is simply God and me. But it is not until our Christianity moves from God and me to me and others that it becomes authentic, that it becomes real. May God give us grace as we celebrate to embrace the four P's that Jesus offers to troubled hearts. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and the people of God say, Amen. Amen. I invite you to stand with me as we reaffirm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. Together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the one universal church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Please be seated. Let us pray. O gracious God, you are the giver of life. You sustain that life within us. You nurture that life, and you provide for each and every one of us from your store. Lord, we thank you for giving us life. We thank you for your blessings, and we thank you for your mercies. Lord, you know when to call us home. You have called our dear sister Ianthe to your home to be with you. And so, Heavenly Father, as we come and celebrate her life, her work, and her witness, we lift this family who mourn before you. We pray, Lord, that you will be with them in this their time of great sorrow, that you will assure them of your love and your mercy and your care and of your presence. Lord, help them to know that you love them and that you will always be with them, and that when they call upon you, you will answer. Father God, hold them in the hollow of your arms, and so that they may always feel your presence and your love. And as they mourn together and support each other, they will draw closer to you. Lord, we pray that the members of your church will uplift them in prayer and attend to their needs, physical as well as spiritual needs, as they request, as they desire. Lord God, we place them in your care and in your keeping. And we know that you will hear us and answer our prayer for Christ's sake. Amen. Now we turn to the prayers of thanksgiving. Praise be to you, O God, our Father, who created us in your own image for eternal fellowship with you. Praise and thanksgiving to you, O Christ, our Lord and our God, who have overcome the sharpness of death and opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers, and are now seated at the right hand of God in the glory of the Father. Praise and blessing be to you, O Holy Spirit, God, our Comforter, who bear witness within us of our acceptance with the Father and have become the pledge of our eternal inheritance. All praise and glory, blessing and honor, thanksgiving and worship be to you, O blessed Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. O gracious God, we bless your name for the life of Sister Ianthe, whom we today lay to rest. We give you thanks for the joy and the blessing her life has brought to others.
for her service to her generation according to your will, and for every happy remembrance of her life. We bless you for your mercy and goodness which have followed her all the days of her life, that now the trials of this world are over and death itself is past. Receive her into your perfect kingdom and bring us with all who have lived and served you faithfully to the fullness of your eternal joy. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Now we're going to sing the hymn, "Through All the Changing Scenes of Life, in Trouble and in Joy, the praises of my God shall still my heart and tongue employ." We stand and sing.
To remain standing for the commendation. We heard in the eulogy that our sister had the privilege of dining with the Queen, of meeting the Pope. This right here, nothing in comparison to any of those. She meets the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, face to face. And she will hear him say, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant, enter now into the joy of your rest." Incomparable. Eternal God, who have made us all and hate nothing that you have made and have given your Son for our redemption, we commend our sister Ianthe to your perfect mercy and wisdom. Eternal rest grant unto her, and let perpetual light shine upon her. And the people of God say, Amen and Amen. The Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. There is no Methodist who has not been significantly blessed, touched, transformed by the next hymn that we shall sing. And can it be that I should gain? Internationally, it is known as the Methodist Anthem. And so we sing it to the glory of God with great zeal and conviction. And can it be that I should gain? After which, Reverend Ezra Barker will pronounce the benediction.
And can it be that I should gain interest in the Savior's blood? Died he for me who causes pain, for me who him to death pursue? Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me? Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me? This mystery of the immortal dies, who can explore its strange design? In vain the firstborn seraph tries to sound the depths of love divine. This mercy all earth adore, let angels' minds inquire no more. His mercy all earth adore, let angels' minds inquire no more. He left his Father's throne above, so free, so infinite his grace, emptied himself of all but love, and bled for Adam's helpless race. His mercy all in God, it found of me. There's mercy, oh, immense and free. For, oh, my God, it found of me. Long my imprisoned spirit
went forth and followed him. My chains fell off, my heart was free. I rose and forth and followed him. No condemnation.
Now the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you perfect in every good thing to do his will, working in you that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen and amen. Please remain in your places until the procession has left the church. Thank you so much.
Children. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never. Worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before, your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on saying. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find to rest the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship his soul. Time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then your holy name. worship your holy name. Worship your holy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever will be. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord. There's a place
where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down at the cross. Lightning bolt where it should go. unattainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees.
Neither death nor life, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height nor depth, nor any other creature can separate us from the love of God which is in Jesus Christ our Lord. We know that if this earthly house of our tabernacle be dissolved, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Since our sister Ianthe has departed out of this life, and Almighty God in His mercy has taken her to Himself, we therefore commit her body to the ground, dust to dust, ashes to ashes, earth to earth, in sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me from henceforth, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for He hath visited and redeemed His people, and hath raised us up a mighty salvation for us in the house of His servant David, as He spoke by the mouth of His holy prophets, which have been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hands of all that hate us.
I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, from henceforth, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Even so says the Spirit, for they rest from their labors. Let us pray. O merciful God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Father of mercies and God of all comfort, raise us up, we pray, from death of sin, to the new life of righteousness, that when we shall depart this life, we shall be found acceptable in your sight. This we pray through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Grant to the bereaved consolation and faith in this time of distress and trial, the blessed hope in the coming of your kingdom, the sustaining grace in the fellowship of your people, and steadfastness in the service of your name and the doing of your will. Support us, O Lord, all this day long of this troublous life, until the shadows lengthen, the evening comes, the busy world is hushed, the fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then, Lord, in your mercy, grant unto us safe lodging, holy rest and peace at the last, through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the people say, Amen and Amen. Him, blessed assurance, Jesus is mine, oh what a foretaste of glory divine.
Thank you. hymn, To God Be the Glory. Heaven, sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace.
The wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will the toils of life.
from Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 to 7. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life. Those who conquer will inherit these things, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." The word of the Lord. When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal, bright and fair, when the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
Thank you.
my brothers and sisters, on behalf of the family of Ianthe Brathwaite, we want to say thanks to you so much for coming out and supporting them in this their time of great sorrow. We thank you so much, and may God bless you all this. Please get home safely. Thank you.
Receive the benediction. May the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. The Lord be with you. Go in peace, and may the God of peace go with you. Amen.
Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. 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 We agree. Amen.